doesn't it? Every family has one of these.
Good morning, respected judges and all my dear friends. We, the students of Deccan College of Medical Sciences, are here to present a symposium on our research project, Neurocognitive Impairment in Obstructive Sleep Apnea.
O-S-A, living the nightmare.
Obstructive, or should we say destructive?
Devastating.
Disastrous.
Wait, is it really that dangerous?
OSA is arguably one of the most underdiagnosed and under-evaluated conditions of the modern era, with a prevalence similar to diabetes mellitus in over 18 million sufferers. It remains undiagnosed in a whopping 80%.
So what exactly is this OSA?
Sleep apnea is a sleep disorder characterized by irregular breathing and snoring patterns that cause periods of apnea where a person stops breathing momentarily. Sleep apnea could be obstructive, central, or mixed. Obstructive being the most common is due to blockage of the airway.
As we know, air passes from the nose through the nasal pharynx into the laryngeopharynx and finally reaching the trachea. A block anywhere along this path, say by energy inducing a swelling of the tissues, swollen adenoids or tonsils, a severe underbite or any other jaw malformation, and the single most important factor being obesity.
Whoa! So will I suffer from sleep apnea if I get fat?
Obesity causes collection of fat around the neck, weighing down the airway. The problem is more obvious at night with a change in posture, coupled with hormonal variations that result in excessive laxity of the pharyngeal muscles, squashing or obstructing the airway.
My father has been snoring for as long as I can remember. How would I know if he has sleep apnea?
The symptoms of the condition include severe sleep deprivation resulting in stress-induced insomnia and nocturia, difficulty in concentration during the daytime, headaches and fatigue, and almost always the entire apnea episode is preceded by loud snoring that can disrupt the sleep of others.
These multiple hypoxic episodes put various body systems under considerable stress, adversely affecting them. Specifically, the nervous system, that's the most sensitive to these apneic, hypercapneic insults. Sleep fragmentation, and thereby daytime sleepiness, affects daily lives and relationships.
In our study, we have tried to both correlate and evaluate the impact of OSA on neurocognition, thereby understand how it both directly and indirectly affects our daily life and activities. 100 OSA patients and 50 control subjects were recruited from the Department of Pulmonology at our teaching hospital.
Their age, gender, BMI, symptoms and other parameters noted in detail. A polysomnography sleep study and an OSA questionnaire were used to confirm the diagnosis. And lastly, for the assessment of neurocognition, they were given a mini mental state examination and a some self-report depression scale.
Here's a peek into the lives of the affected.
Hello, this is Pearson. This is the principal here. We forgot to pick up kids up. I believe this is the third time this month.
Oh no, I'm on my way.
From trivial day-to-day things like losing your keys and forgetting appointments to something like chattering.
Just like any other Wednesday morning, Mrs. Pearson made breakfast for the kids, dropped them off, and was on her way to work, glad to make run times to change. Am I forgetting something?
He installed 78 Ferraris in one of his garage just for decoration. He In the next 10 years, these growth charts were expected to go through the roof. Dad is still in his 50s. His unhealthy lifestyle, coupled with addictions, made him a victim of obstructive sleep apnea. It first began with disorientation and lack of interest, but with increased daytime somnolence, he was soon engulfed with anxiety, anger, exhaustion, and frustration, which eventually cost him everything that he worked so hard for.
We found a deficit in the attention and cognition scores of the patients in contrast to the control, both of which determine one's work productivity.
Seems like John is finally slumbering peacefully after a long day of work.
No way! Wasn't he driving back home with his family?
Heartbreaking, isn't it? If you think so, then sit with your heart held tight. Because this was just a glimpse. There are many other man-made catastrophes due to OSA waiting for our acknowledgement. For instance, the Canadian National Train Wreck. Two trains slammed into each other in 2001. The safety board's investigation concluded that the conductor on one of the trains was incapacitated by fatigue caused by the unsuccessfully treated sleep apnea.
The Hoboken train crash of 29 September 2016 is another example where the driver Thomas Gallagher suffered from OSA, which was undiagnosed until after the crash.
Despite the spinal metronaut derailment affecting the lives of 115, was the deadliest train accident within New York City. NTSB investigations reveal that the engineer, William Rockefeller, had gone into a daze before reaching the curb. A medical exam concluded that he suffered from sleep apnea. According to 27 observation studies, it has been concluded that the subjects suffering with sleep disorders had 1.62 times higher risk of being injured while at work.
In our study, we found that the orientation and registration capacity of the patients was significantly impaired.
Oh, that wasn't something we were expecting, were we?
In a nutshell, we found some strong discrepancies in the attention, memory, and executive function scores of the OSA subjects.
So, is there a solution? The golden age-old principle of early diagnosis and treatment holds good for OSA as well.
Firstly, a continuous positive airway pressure device designed as per the patient's comfort and requirements. Coupling with lifestyle changes like a healthy diet and regular exercise, avoiding alcohol and any depressive medications, sleeping on the side with the head elevated, surgical direction in a few selected cases.
It's about time we become aware of this underrated predicament, especially in India, where it is highly underestimated and helps the sufferers, rather than let them live the nightmare.
And now to conclude, let us take you all to a parallel universe, where Mrs. Pearson, John, and Tony did not ignore their subtle symptoms of OSA and sought early treatment. See how that worked out for them.
We forgot we are in sighted position. But in the process, subject has become little less and the audience has become more. It's overtaking. I have a simple question. What are the muscles responsible for the dilation of pharynx, common? Which are the muscles?
The pharyngeal muscle, laxity, is causing this, sir?
Muscles.
The constrictor, sir. The superior inferior constrictor.
Name the
muscles. The superior. Remove the superior inferior constrictor, sir.
Okay.
So apart from that, the soft palate, the denser palate is also in the old age which also contributes.
Very specific, don't tell me what are the muscles responsible for the penetration of the varices, for the breathing. People were analyzed.
Yes, sir.
How many people were screened to find out 100 people? What is the incidence of OSA in your hospital?
In our hospital, sir, after taking a polysomnography and confirming that 100 patients had done polysomnography and were confirmed to have the sleep apnea, they were classified based on the apnea hypoapnea index. That is, the number of times they suffered the apnea and hypoapnea tests per hour. We had mild, moderate and severe categories. Mild were about 23%, moderate were the majority, about 35%, and only the rest were in the severe category, having more than 30 times stopping their airway and having apneic episodes per hour of sleep at night. The general incidence is 1 in 20. Important when they suffer from such things and take care of the condition, use CPAP early and not think that it is uncomfortable or is not helping them sleep easily, and get used to it so that in a couple of weeks after they adjusted to the mask, even if it's uncomfortable, they'll not only be protected against stroke, cardiovascular abnormalities, metabolic syndromes, hypertension, etc., but also the basic advantage of having a refreshed sleep in the next morning is the most immediate thing that they will see. Almost everybody will benefit, but surgery, the most common one is the maxillofacial surgery.
Or even
the tonsillectomy, etc. also. Ma'am. In fact, even children are suffering from sleep apnea because of these adenoid enlargements and pulses. So for them, it is a common surgery. But the maxillofacial surgeries are very rare, only when they are affording it and they are taking it seriously enough, only then they take it. Males to females are almost in ratio 3:1. Males are highly showing not only a more incidence but also have a higher AHI score. Amongst our severe patients, the majority were males.
What is the definition of
sleep apnea?
What is the definition?
Sleep apnea is the obstruction of the airway. Apnea being considered more than 90% reduction in the airway for at least a period of 10 seconds and a fall in oxygen saturation by at least 4%. On the other hand, hypoapnea means at least a 50% reduction in the airway for at least 10 seconds and an increase in oxygen saturation of again 4%. Yes, we use polysomnography because it is considered the gold standard, and we have a sleep lab which is giving us the equipment for the same. So we could make it easy for the patients by using polysomnography.
What is the medical
name? Medical management, yes sir. As such, medical management cannot help the collapse in the airway.
Apart from my lifestyle modification.
So that's the 10 minutes. So this is the 10 minutes.